In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask you pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. And then we were on the third week, as the saying would go. We're already on the third week of the new ordinary time. How fast time flies. Man's life on earth is like the flowers in the field. One day they're there and the next day they're gone. Somebody would even say, a spiritual writer, it's in scripture. It's like a lightning that you haven't even heard the end of the thunder that follows it or that goes with it, that went with it, and it's already gone. This life is passing through. This world that at times we tend to absolutize, the goods in it, the joys in it, and the sorrows. By now, starting the new year, perhaps we've been confronted with the challenges that this year brings with it. The attempt to live the new normal, if we really wanted a new normal and I just drift to the old one. But have a stout heart, again, our Lord himself would say. In this world, you will have tribulation. In hoc mundo pressura mabetis, you will have pressures, you'll have tensions, you'll have trials. You'll be tested because this world, even if you, my Lord, made it perfect, has been damaged by man's sinfulness, such that what should be happening without any effort, which is the good of creation, the good of your plan, now has become a repair, which definitely therefore would require effort, would entail pain at times, sometimes real difficult pain. In hoc mundo pressura mabetis, configete, ego vinci mundum. But have a stout heart, it said, because I have overcome the world. I have overcome the world. You, my Lord, have overcome it. And how did you overcome it? By dying on the cross. Living that life that we had been meditating on these past weeks and months. Lord, how can we not fall in love with you? After all you've done, after the example that you have given us, after knowing that life, I remember a film, a show once, a movie, long ago, that said something like this, to know me is to love me. It was an affirmation of a lady. Then I think of Our Lady. Magnificat anima mea Domina. My soul magnifies the Lord. And my heart rejoices in God my Savior. Henceforth, all generations will call me blessed. Because he who was almighty has done great things in me. And holy is his name. See, that's the salvific will of God. That's the merciful will of God. That's the loving will of God. He really wants to make us saints because it's what he created us for, to be with him. So that those words, of course, they were applied strictly to the apostles after calling his disciples and praying all night, he called 12 to be with him, really stick close. They were for the next 20 months or so. They were together in a continuous formation, continuous transformation, continuous Christification, because our Lord was going to die and going to resurrect and going to go to heaven. And his work had to be continued up to the end of time. That's the apostolate. And so now we're 3 weeks into the new, shall we say, ordinary time. And as we proposed at the beginning of it, we're going to be meditating on the life of our Lord as narrated by St. Mark. It's a second pasada, a second review, a second, why not say it, loving glance. You remember the time when you fell in love for the first time, and a glance was not enough. There had to be a second, and a third, and a fourth. Little did you know that that was going to be the person that you would spend the rest of your life with. Do you still take those loving glances, those stolen glances, which now maybe you don't need to steal because he's there, she's there to be looked at, to be contemplated, to be glanced at with love? Well, that's what we do every time we read the Holy Gospels. Not just once, not just twice, many times. And that's why to that question that I'm sometimes asked, when do you prepare your homilies? When do you prepare these meditations? And I have to confess that many times there's no quote-unquote preparation, immediate preparation. Like now, for example, we're just going to be reading the gospel. I have no outline anywhere. The outlines are in my head, maybe. Why? Because I had meditated on these passages many times. I brought them to the prayer many times. And each time our Lord shows himself a little bit more. That's what should happen when we contemplate. And that's the kind of prayer I've been trying to guide you into. But it has its consequences, as we shall see. Then he went home, and the crowd came together again so that they could not even eat. And when his friends heard it, they went out to seize him, for they said, he's beside himself. That's actually the verse before the verses of today's gospel, in between the verses that we read before and now, that we shall read now. And I just brought it up because it's curious how it said there that his friends seized him when they saw that the crowds had come, because they thought he was beside himself. What is that? And then put yourself in the situation. Our Lord had been busy the previous day talking to the crowds. He has spent the whole night in prayer, so no sleep. The following day, again, the disciples were still there, called them, and he chose 12. Now they were identified as the inner 12. They got to know each other closer. And at the end of that day, he went home. Home where? Oh, I don't know. One of the houses there. And then the crowds followed him. And just like at other times, when it would state it specifically, instead of sending them away, it's again nighttime. This is the second night that he's going to spend attending to the crowds or praying. Instead of doing that, he was going to confront them again. Minister to them. Teach them, heal their sick, cast out demons. That was what was going to happen. And his newfound friends, the disciples, who were not slow nor lazy, as they would say in Spanish, ni tonto ni perezoso. Of course, thinking about his welfare, He's beside himself. It's like he's possessed with apostolic zeal. He can't help himself. He's going to minister to them again. And so they kind of kidnap him. It's time to rest. I suppose they even went out there to disperse the crowd. Can't you come tomorrow? Can't you see that it is going to be the second straight night, or I don't know, perhaps even three, that the master is not going to be able to rest? So that was the idea there. Because the priestly soul, the mark of the priestly soul, as St. Jose Maria used to say, is never saying enough. Never saying no to the souls in need. Never saying no to our confession. Never saying no to somebody asking for advice. Never saying no to somebody asking for the sacraments. Because an argument can be made intellectually, juridically. I'm a canon lawyer. I have a doctor in canon law. And it can be said that the faithful have a right to the sacraments. Not the right vis-a-vis God. Sacraments were given, instituted by Jesus Christ freely. It was a gift. But once he has instituted them and organized the church the way he did, then every faithful has a right to the sacraments vis-a-vis or in front of the hierarchy. Meaning to say the pastors, the priests under them. Why? Because those people, the hierarchy, were instituted in order to deliver the sources of salvation, those three things of teaching with authority, the word of God, to administering the sacraments, not only validly, but in the right dose, not the minimum dose, but the right dose. The right dose for what? For making saints. Make no mistake about it. If the doses of the sacraments is not enough for people to struggle seriously for holiness, then somebody's goofing. And then third, to govern. The third is just a function of the first two. To be able to teach properly and administer the sacraments properly, then there has to be a certain level of governance, of organization. And that's what our Lord gave Peter and the apostles, the authority to do that, to organize the church so that they could teach properly and they could administer the sacraments properly. And that's the reason why at a given moment, you read this in the Acts of the Apostles, when the converts from the Gentiles were complaining that the apostles were not attending to their widows properly or enough, well, the apostles said, well, that's not our job, so let's appoint deacons who would take care of that so that we can dedicate ourselves to preaching the word and administering sacraments. You see, that's what governance is all about. Not organizing political rallies, not organizing a beauty pageant, not organizing whatever heck can be organized there, but to organize the church so that the word of God can be preached. And I'm sorry that came out. And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, he is possessed by Beelzebul and by the prince of demons. He casts out the demons. And he called them to him and said to them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is coming to an end. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. Then indeed, he may plunder his house. This is getting more and more abstruse, right? But we will explain. Truly, I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the sons of men, and whatever blasphemies they utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin, because they had said he had an unclean spirit. This is one of the hardest passages in sacred scripture in the gospel. One of the pronouncements of our Lord, which is not only difficult to understand, but even when understood in a certain way, to a certain extent, is difficult to swallow. Because haven't we said that God is a forgiving God? That God is disposed to forgive everything? That sin that severs the relationship with God is a one-way affair, in the sense that what severs the relationship is only from our point of view, only from the sinner's point of view. He's the one who turns his back on God. God doesn't unfriend him, so to speak. God is a good father. Just like the parable of the prodigal son, the father did not disown that child or disinherit him. Actually, he gave him the inheritance even ahead of time. On the contrary, he was always loving that son, waiting for his return. And when he did return, he welcomed him with open arms, restoring him to his original position as his son. So therefore, what does this passage mean? We need to understand this because it has important repercussions. Our Lord was talking about the sin, the so-called sin against the Holy Spirit, which according to him cannot be forgiven. Something that immediately leaps at us and perhaps causes an interior objection, because we had always said that God forgives everything. Now, what is this sin against the Holy Spirit that our Lord was talking about? What did you mean, my Lord? Sin against the Spirit. Our Lord was referring to the fact that the principle of supernatural life of the soul. Remember, we have a natural life, which is spiritual. We have a body, we have a soul that's spiritual, a spirit that's capable of knowing and loving. But God was not content with that in the design of man. We have read it so many times, referred to it so many times, that God made man from the slime of the earth to his image. And then he breathed into him the ruah, his own breath, his own spirit, the same one that was supervising the creation at the beginning of time. Now he infuses it in man. What for? For man to participate in his life. So man, infused by the Holy Spirit, informed by the Holy Spirit, becomes a new kind of organism, so to speak, a new creature. He's elevated. He's not just a creature now, period, like all the other creatures out there. He's not even just an intelligent and free being now, as he should have been had he not been infused with the Holy Spirit. But he became a son of God, whose principle of life, what life is that? You know, what moves him to know, what moves him to act freely, is not anymore just the natural constitution of human nature with a spirit that is spiritual and therefore capable of knowing and loving. That would be natural man. But no, he has become the supernatural man, participating in the life of God. Mind you, we considered this when we considered divine filiation last Sunday, the baptism of our Lord, or two Sundays ago, that man never really existed in a purely natural state. Now, it's not as if God created Adam and Eve, gave them a natural human nature, the human nature, rather, composed of a body informed by a spiritual soul, which is capable of knowing and loving. And then Act 2, because that was going well, he breathed into them the breath of life and now elevated them to the supernatural order of being children of God. No, it's not like that. The formation of man from the other hominids, the previous generation were still hominids, like, I don't know what, the Peking man, the Java man, the Cro-Magnon. And then the next generation, in a particular line of evolution, became Adam and Eve, and God infused. That now has a soul, intelligent and free, unlike the gorillas or those other hominids who were not intelligent and free. They acted as if they were intelligent and free, but actually not. Like you see a chimp, it seems like it's free, but no, it doesn't have a spiritual soul, not yet. Now, the first man and the first woman had spiritual souls. But in that same moment that they got that spiritual soul, because of the directed evolution being done by God, he also infused his own breath. And that's the reason why the word used there is "and," not "then." God made man from the slime of the earth and, concomitant, the same act, breathed into him the breath of life. So he became a living being. And that's the reason why when Adam and Eve lost that gift of the Holy Spirit, it was such a humongous thing. Because besides, it was going to be passed on. Imagine if, for example, if one insane moment that in the history of mankind, there was a couple who had the option to retain the characteristic of human beings to have a head, or to have two arms, or to have whatever in their body. And then freely they decided to lose it. So from now on, we only have one arm. From now on, we won't have a head, or we only have one leg, or whatever. And therefore, henceforth, all their descendants up to us will only have one arm or one leg. And you would have thought that's terrible, right? And it's just an arm and a leg at the end of the day. So what? You know? But to lose our participation in the divine life, to lose our participation in the inner dynamics of the three divine persons. Now, my brothers, do you understand why God, quote unquote, italics, had to do what he did to redeem us, to save us, to give us back that state? Do you realize just how big that thing was that we lost? And such a good father that he is, he didn't want us to lose it just like that. Oh my God. When are we going to appreciate this fully and value it fully? So that we don't take it for granted that we're in the Catholic Church, that we're recipients of a tradition, not only of the Word of God, but of the sacraments. That we have the hierarchy, the organization, the software and the hardware for us to make that life real and vibrant, not languish there. And that's what the sin against the Holy Spirit means. When a person denies the activity, the authorship, the effect of the Holy Spirit in the soul of the person. So that is put aside. Because what does that mean, actually? It means bringing him back to the state of the fall of man, of Adam and Eve, when they rejected the love of God and got out of paradise. And caused generations, many generations, for thousands of years of humanity without that participation. And so therefore leaving man again in a state of utter subjection to his wiles without that grafting into the life of God and ushering in again the reign of the devil. That's what that means. What a life is that? Is to go back to the state of being almost like a chimp, except, okay, an intelligent one. But a chimp, nevertheless. Once I told you that when the film first came out, the film of Mel Gibson, The Passion of the Christ, that there was a local author, a columnist, an artist, who reviewed the film, and in front of all the criticism of some, shall we say, writers, journalists from abroad that had said that Mel Gibson had overdone it, you know, so much blood and gore, etc., etc. And then this author, who I respected more since that moment. I had respected him even before that, because he's related to somebody who I hold dear in my heart. Said something like this, no? But in all that blood, and I see a certain beauty in all that blood and gore. At that time, I was already taking up philosophy, and so it caught my attention. But since he wasn't taking up philosophy, what he experienced was the artistic moment and saw the beauty in that, but he didn't pursue it. At least he didn't write it down. Because, pardon me if I delve into this a bit, no? In philosophy and metaphysics, beauty is defined as a certain proportion in being. What we call beauty is a transcendental. It applies to all things, everything that exists, now, this notion of beauty. It's when we appreciate a certain proportion in that thing. What is beautiful is proportionate. The opposite of that is monstrous. A monstrosity is precisely something that you don't see proportion. Some things are too large for what it should be, etc., etc. Then it becomes ghastly. No? Now, the question is, and at that moment, that's what I perceived in that writing and what struck my attention. What did he see? What proportion was he talking about? And that gentleman comes from a Catholic tradition. I know the family. I know the dad. with fondness. But anyway, what do you call this? He may not have been able to articulate it at that moment, but precisely as I told you, I was already taking up philosophy at that time and theology, so therefore I saw what he meant. The proportion that he saw is what we had just been considering right now. The proportion between the good that had been lost, which is divine filiation, divine sonship, the participation in the inner life of the Blessed Trinity, lost by sin, and the sacrifice that God was willing to do, subject his own son to, in order to win him back. So when we see the blood and the gore and the suffering, the inhumanity that our Lord had to pass through, may we never forget what for, and see the proportion, and therefore the beauty. Oh, my Lord, of course you had to do it. Of course you had to go through that passion. Because that's what love does. It has no measure for the good of the beloved. And your heart, my Lord, was bursting with love for all of mankind, not just for the people of past generations, but everyone, we included, up to the end of time. And so when they were hammering down those nails, and before that, with those lashes, you were already thinking of me. You were already thinking of all of us who are doing this prayer now, and those who will come after, and who would have need of that redemption to be restored to divine sonship. And all of that is put aside, shredded once more by the person who denies the Holy Spirit. Maybe in principle he won't say, I deny the Holy Spirit, but who in effect denies him because doesn't relate with him, doesn't pay attention to him, whatever the Holy Spirit does has no consequences in his life. Once I heard a parent complaining, because of all the sacrifices that he and the wife had gone through in order to give their children the opportunities that they never had, to go to a good school, etc., etc. And one of them precisely was malfunctioning, so to speak, like the prodigal son. Wasting his time, flunking courses, dropping subjects. And so that parent was feeling very bad because precisely of the lack of appreciation for the sacrifices. This is what the sin against the Holy Spirit means. And the reason why Christ said it's unforgivable is because a person in that situation is not in the disposition to be forgiven. In other words, the father of the prodigal son was waiting there, ready. But if the prodigal son had not gone back, had not first of all made up his mind to humiliate himself and to accept his mistake and to go back and to be willing to be treated as just another servant, just so he could survive, because at least there was food aplenty, while where he was, there was famine, and he was just trying to eat what the pigs were eating. And that's the position of the person who, in technical terms, is sinning against the Holy Spirit, denying the Holy Spirit, denying as in factoring out, such that the Holy Spirit, who should be the principle of supernatural life, the principle of godliness in the baptized person in the state of grace, ceases to be that principle, such that that individual is left to his, what? To the state of not having God, not being grafted to him. So therefore what? Because some people say, okay, never mind the supernatural element. Can't I just be natural? The answer to that is no. Because natural man, as we said before, never really existed. So the choice is either we are supernatural with the Holy Spirit guiding us, or we are infranatural. We have the Holy Spirit, we have a wounded nature, and so there's all the other people out there, and you have the devil, and you have the material things, the disordered world, not totally disordered, slightly only, but still. And you have the devil there, like a roaring lion, just waiting to snap whoever. That's why it's unforgivable. Quote unquote, hopeless. Truly, truly, I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the sons of men. And whatever blasphemies they utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin, because they had said he is an unclean spirit. We have to end. And there's one more point that I'd like to raise here. Those people, I mean the scribes and the Pharisees who were there trying to put our Lord down, had gone there observing and had seen what he was doing, the doctrine that he had been preaching, the good that he was bringing about, and yet they still denied him. And our Lord classified that as the typical illustration of the sin against the Holy Spirit, because they were refusing to accept the fact that he was guided by the Holy Spirit, that what he was doing was informed by the Holy Spirit. Doesn't it remind you of, again, pardon me for belaboring this point, but it's ongoing. And as good children of the church, you have to be aware of this. We all have to be aware of this. The attacks against the Holy Father, the refusal to accept the special help that Peter has because of that promise of our Lord in Caesarea Philippi. You are the rock upon which I will build my church, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, so that whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth is loose in heaven. People who keep on denying that, isn't that an attack against the Holy Spirit? Isn't that the denial of the fact that the Holy Spirit is the soul of the church and is taking care of his church? To accept that there is a Pope, that there is a vicar of Christ, that there is a successor of Peter who is doing things at the margin of what the Holy Spirit would want the church to be, is a contradiction in terms. And there's a reason why, even in this 20th century history of the church, there may have been popes who might have been less than ideal as far as their personal virtues or lack of it is concerned, and there have been some of those. But when it came to the policies regarding the church, when it came to their magisterium, when it came to the discipline that they instituted, the Holy Spirit did not allow them to bungle it up. For one very simple reason, it's common sense. If you put yourself in the situation of the Blessed Trinity, who is going to establish a church, who is going to prolong the work of Jesus Christ for the redemption, the salvation of mankind to the end of time, okay? And that's the reason why he constituted the hierarchy, sacred ministers, put the sacraments there, etc., etc. A fantastic design. You know what? He's going to leave that possibility of somebody who's in the top position to bungle it up? I mean, that doesn't make much sense. And there's a reason why somebody who thinks that way, again, is sinning against the Holy Spirit. He's making the Holy Spirit a fool. Pardon me, I'm going to use a term which in Tagalog is very harsh. But it's exactly what this means. And people have to see this, especially those who are falling into this, so that they unravel, they unmask whatever it is that they are belaboring under. Kinagago nyo naman yung Holy Spirit. That's the term that we would use in Tagalog. That you're making a fool out of the paraclete. He's not going to allow that to happen. Okay, enough of that, and let's twist this. Because the opposite attitude to this is faith. It's operative hope. Maybe it should have said operative faith, which is hope. And which is all fueled by love, the love for God, the love for the church, the love for his salvific will. And so therefore, a boundless optimism in the work of salvation. That God wins his battles. And the consequence of that is that all of us too will have this mindset of winning our battles. That we don't struggle to lose, we struggle to win. That we have to understand very well that concept, you know, that to err is human and to forgive divine. Yes. But that's an a posteriori consideration. If after, you know, all the optimism and all the effort, honest effort, we still trip and fail, well, okay, then we have to get up. But it's not the attitude of a person who, even before struggling, already saying that, well, to err is human and God will forgive me. That's the attitude of the loser. And we can't be losers. We play to win. You see that in the writings of St. Paul, no? The comparison with the athlete. And everyone goes out there to try to win the prize. You don't join a race thinking that you're going to lose anyway. Then why join at all? But even for those of us who join marathons and all these kinds of events, not even hoping for a podium finish, because we know our times. But for many of those who join a marathon, 2,000 plus of them, what they're after is just to finish and to improve their personal best. They know their time, not to be 1, 2, 3. The 1, 2, 3 there, those are for the Kenyans and the Nigerians and the Ethiopians who make a living out of this thing, no? Because they really run in a very scary way, you know. But nobody joins a race knowing that he's not going to finish. Or that, anyway, he's not going to even improve his personal best. What for? No? We play to win. Why? Because we know that the Holy Spirit is acting in our soul in grace. And the Holy Spirit, in principle, does not lose battles. So we're not going to lose ours as well. Let's go to our Blessed Mother, as always. You know what happens? I used to be chaplain of a high school, a school for boys. you know, in the baseball games, the football games, and there's this phenomenon of the football moms and the tennis moms, to the point that there came a time when we even prohibited them from coming already, because precisely of the problem of gender identification. We want to make their sons manly, you know, and not tugging at their apron strings, so to speak, or their skirts. But you can't help it. Moms are the number one supporters of their children. And in this battle, the battle to win, especially this time of the year when we're just beginning, precisely, we need a mother. So let's go to our Blessed Mother. Oh, my mother, help me fight. Help me struggle in earnest. But most of all, help me win.